With the Oscar campaign for Elvis in full swing, more and more audiences are seeing the pivotal role black music played in his sound, especially in a time where black artists were widely shut out of the mainstream market.
You ain't nothing but...
Sometimes record companies saw a black hit and they just knew that the record would be bigger if it was by a white singer. Then you get people like Elvis, you later get people like the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, who seem to have a more genuine connection with the music and actually often spoke about who their influences were. Even when they reach through to their audiences about their influences, they can't make their audiences that just likes their floppy hair or what have you go out and buy a record by Little Richard or any of the other innovators. In the very early days of rock and roll, in terms of on radio, it was all black music. And the idea of rock and roll was just kind of a marketing concept. That's when, let's say, there would be more pop-oriented stations that would only play these type of records if they were by white artists.
It wasn't until Berry Gordy and the birth of Motown Records that audiences finally saw black artists in the forefront, finding crossover success on pop radio.
Instead of breaking up, let's do some kissing and making up.
I think it was totally all credit goes to Berry Gordy and Motown Records. He was really the mastermind behind crossover, and it was so impactful because Motown was called the sound of young America.
Oh, baby, give me one more chance.
He was already acknowledging that black music was already the sound of young America. It's just that some of it was being sung by white people. So it was almost like claiming, yes, this is the sound of young America, and in this case, it's being done by black artists.
It was last summer when the queen herself, Beyoncé, gifted all of us with Renaissance, an album that serves as a love letter to black queer culture dedicated to her late uncle Johnny.
I think that's what's wonderful about Renaissance is that it's this beautiful conversation between the aspects of queer culture that she's been influenced by and the aspects of queer culture that she's influenced.
I'm that girl.
It's a celebration of self. It's a celebration of community. It's a celebration of eroticism, you know, which went downhill for many people during the pandemic.
Having gotten her start singing with the ladies of Destiny's Child, we are now seeing more than ever how Queen Bee's vocal and performance styles have influenced a whole new generation of solo artists and girl groups, including newcomers Flo.
I love the way that they sing. They don't make just light pop music, and that's something that I'm just sick to death of, you know? And I don't think it reflects our time because we're living really serious times.
Today's musical landscape is also seeing an influx of talented female rappers who are taking over hip hop one hit at a time.
They can't be Nicki, they sound stupid. I just laugh when they try.
I think we're just finally seeing just the incredible impact of what Nicki Minaj has been able to do ever since the beginning of her career. You can go the Nicki pop lane and have a whole career just based upon how she approached pop. You can go the Nicki hardcore rap lane.
So I tell him it's one of me, he making fun of me. His girl is a bum to me.
People can have whole careers based upon just one aspect of what you did. I think that's pretty profound.
Known as the founding members of CNC Music Factory, David Cole and Robert Clavillis helped usher in a new era of house music with hits like Gonna Make You Sweat.
When house first came to New York, the electro sound was really, really big. Some clubs wanted to hear more house stuff, and some clubs still wanted to have the electro stuff. So Cole and Clavillis were one of the first producers to do both.
After a taste of mainstream success, it wasn't long before some 90s divas came calling, including the elusive chanteuse herself, Miss Mariah Carey.
Mariah and David's relationship was more like a conversation. It was more like, do you remember this record? Oh, but do you remember this record? Oh, do you remember this record? That's why I think they were able to make such great records, like Make It Happen. the first time I went into a Black gay club, like, it wasn't all the current hits. I mean, they would play the hit records and then they would throw on some kind of old disco song. And, you know, they would teach you what the history of this music was, and that would be kind of shaping your taste.
And Mariah isn't the only songbird the duo lent their talents to.
When they initially heard her cover of I'm Every Woman, they were like, oh my God, this is horrible. This is the worst thing we've ever heard. Whitney was several months pregnant and thought she was finished with the album. And you know, when Whitney was off work, she was off work. And they had to beg her to come down to re-sing. But it ultimately turned out so well that they used those versions for the album versions, for the remix versions. And it's one of the best dance records of all time. It stands up as a superlative cover. Not only was it making an important and kind of contemporary cultural statement by doing these house remixes, it also opened up certain markets in order to make the people ultimately bigger stars.